Psalms confirm that God is our refuge. I decided to write my talk on this topic because I believe it brings a comfort and stability in God that is important to have as a Christian. His refuge has only grown in significance to me throughout the process of writing this paper. It is a steady hope through trials and hardships. Studying Psalms 46 and 91 confirms that God is a refuge to his people. These Psalms, as well as the rest of the Bible, seem to define the biblical definition of refuge as God's shelter from all that is produced by sin. In my research, I demonstrated that Psalm 46 defends the idea that the refuge of God encompasses protection, peace, and security for the believer. This is no little thing, for God desires to be our refuge. We have peace that surpasses understanding, protection, and security from the enemy. The knowledge that he desires to be this for us is revealed in these Psalms. Through God's refuge, we have an escape from ourselves and from the sinful world we live in. This escape is a blessing that all Christians should be aware of. However, there is another response to these verses. In the refutation to my argument, the opposing view claims that the Psalms do not confirm that God is our refuge. Some would claim that God is to be feared or not trusted. They could claim that he is dangerous and to be hidden from, and that our sin causes us to be unwanted by God. They would argue that people cannot find refuge in a person whom they fear. They could say that he would not be seen as protector, but instead as someone who is to be feared, not out of reverence, but instead out of distrust. The error in these claims were exploited, and the truth in what the refuge of God provides was again proven. God desires to take us in, take refuge. God desires us to take refuge in him, and through it he provides peace and protection. In Psalm 91, we have a list of numerous instances in which taking refuge in God allows people to feel peace and to be protected by him. God makes them safe from the fowler, the deadly pestilence, the terror of the night, the arrow that flies by day, the pestilence that stalks in darkness, destruction and noonday, and the plague. Psalm 91:3-10. These images give greater vividness to the extreme extent to which the Lord protects, even saying in verse 7 and 8, 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. Psalms 91:7-8. He provides refuge in himself and wants us to have it. It is clear that suffering is definitely a part of every person's existence, but God promises that he will be there throughout it all. Christians will face adversities, but God's children will be able to turn to him as their refuge during hardship. Psalm 91, verses 14 through 17, it is written, because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. This demonstrates how God responds when Christians run to him. This is a blessing and outlet by which to praise God. That being said, I will end with the same verse I began my thesis, Psalms 46:1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. I will now leave it up to the judges to ask questions pertaining to my thesis.
I think I'll start by asking, what struck you the most or impacted you the most while you were doing this?
I think that learning about God's desire to have us take refuge in him was just incredibly impactful. Because you hear a lot about refuge in of itself and the things that it contains, but just hearing that he desires to be that refuge was incredibly impactful.
I did want to just begin again as I did with Cole and just commend you on completing your thesis. You did it, yay. And I just found in the tone of your paper just such a kind of what you're communicating as well in person, that wonder and joy at the truth that's expressed in these Psalms. And I think that's just a super refreshing and wonderful thing for you to bring to this thesis event. So the first thing I wanted to ask, you mentioned in your abstract. You mentioned in your abstract your your definition of a refuge, which you say is God's shelter from all that is produced by sin. Could you unpack that a little bit or tell us how you came to that as your definition?
So throughout reading the Psalms, I felt like so many things were pertaining or involved with the word refuge, and seeing that people were taking refuge in him from enemies, were taking refuge in him from outside wars or from like disasters, just seeing all the different things that they were able to run to him with, and seeing that I felt like I needed a broad enough definition showing that anything that is affected by the sinful curse, we can find refuge in him. So, I don't know if that answers the question.
No, it does.
Okay.
You made a point that God's children are not counted among the wicked. You quoted a psalm. And I was just wondering if you could elaborate more on that too. Like, we all sin and fall short. So why are God's children?
Absolutely. So I reference that because we are covered by the blood of Jesus. We are 100% wicked people, but because we have been covered, we are not counted among the wicked.
And I know from other experiences that you are a poet, and so it does not surprise me that the Psalms would appeal to you in this way. And this idea of refuge, I think, is such a beautiful thing in Scripture. And there are, within these two Psalms, and then elsewhere in Scripture, pictures or metaphors of how God is a refuge. Were there any in particular, any of those images or metaphors that spoke to you that just really... The one example is fortress, but that's kind of what I'm talking about. But there are plenty of other images. Is there anything that really that's an image that you just love?
Yes. So in Psalms 91, at the very end, verses 14 through 16, I actually quote it in the abstract, but I can just go ahead and read it.
Sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. So I felt like that was just really awesome to hear again, that this refuge provides that and is involved in that. And that, because he holds fast to God in love, that he will deliver him. He'll be that refuge and I will see him.
Are there any of the images that might have appealed to you more, like rock or fortress? Or I think one of these psalms also talks about the pinions, the wings, that he hides in the shadow of his wings. I just didn't know if any of those kind of poetic images spoke to you.
Yes, as a poet. Under the wings, 100%. Sorry, I didn't understand.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. That's why I followed up.
I love the metaphor that under his wings you will find refuge. That was my favorite. All the listings.
I love the correlation that you made between Psalm 46:3 and Matthew 8:24-26. I love that that you tied those two together and then followed it by "Be still and know that I'm God." And I feel like that really nailed in your point of like God is a refuge to us. It's like that, but being still and then God being still. I love that.
That
fade
into peace also.
Yeah. Yeah. It was so good. How would you argue or show someone God is a refuge when all they see is chaos? Like, I feel like that's often a common argument that you hear, like, why did bad things happen to the good people? Like,
I could honestly bring up the scripture that I have in the first place as just saying that, like, he is in control of all of it. I touched on it a little bit on the political aspect thesis, but just showing his control over all of it and showing that during the hardships, during the hard things, through all of it, he is in 100% absolute control. And so we can find refuge in the fact that even through the disasters, there's meaning in them and there's purpose for them. Even the things we encounter in daily life. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
Just a little. A little gentleman. So someone reads the psalm and it says, 1,000 will fall at your side, 10,000, no plagues will touch you.
Yeah.
You know? So someone says, but that's not my experience. My friend this morning, her son is having a biopsy on a tumor in his chest. He's 18 years old. Where does she go for refuge when it says these things won't touch you, but they are touching her? So what? How do we reconcile that, I guess?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like that's such a good point to bring up. And I think I would just go back to the control aspect, and that even in the hardships, even when terrible and hard things are happening around you, that there's a sense of control that you can lean on to find your refuge and pick up.
I did have a question for you. On page 10, you were arguing your point, or you were coming up with the counterpoint. You stated in the first paragraph that it says, you're quoting Psalm 46:6, the Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our fortress, Selah. And then you said, displaying that although he, God, is dangerous and able to cause the earth to melt, God is also a fortress to his children. Could you elaborate more on what you mean by God being dangerous?
I just mean that the fact that he is powerful and that he will enact his wrath. And so for anyone not under the wing of our Father, he is a dangerous God. Mm-hmm. And all likelihood should be feared. 100%. I just think it goes back to wrath. Because if you're not under that wing, there will be justice.
Beautiful truth of the gospel that God provides what he requires, right? We need refuge from his wrath, and he provides it himself. As you pointed out, and making that Matthew connection, that Jesus is a refuge. So were there other places, and I know you were focusing on these two Psalms, were there other things that happen in the Old Testament or New Testament places that you look to as this is another really, because it's one narrative, right, from the beginning to the end. Where else do we see refuge in this refuge?
Absolutely. There's reference if you...
No, absolutely.
But yeah, I did specifically try to focus in on those two Psalms just because that's what I had in my thesis statement. However, if you go back to Isaiah 25:4, I'll just read the verse, I guess. You have been a refuge for the poor, a stronghold for the needy and distressed, a refuge from the storm, a shade from the heat, for the breath of the ruthless is like rain in its torrent. So even back in Isaiah, and then obviously in the Psalms, and all the way back into Matthew, throughout the whole Bible, you're able to find and, follow the refuge.
I love the tie between God is a God of justice, but then the Bible is on there, right? He sent Jesus to be the ultimate refuge, right? And I think making sure to tie in that whole gospel really clears up how can a God that is causing chaos and destruction, or allowing chaos and destruction, also be a loving God, right? And it's that's where you have to tie in Jesus too. Seeing that whole picture and really hearing your paper and seeing your paper and just how it connects to the gospel, so powerful. I had a question. How would you argue the reverent fear that is due a God of desolation, that was a quote from Psalm 46:8, versus a fear of distrust? How do you reconcile with these verses when a God of refuge is one that is also peace, is one that is peaceful and secure? I think what I'm kind of getting at is, how would you talk to somebody when they don't like want to trust the Lord, they fear Him? How do you turn that to a reverent fear?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely. I would pressure the point of the fact that He's a loving God, and that yes, He's powerful, yes, He has wrath, yes, He's just, but He isn't the one. And so, even in that fear of distrust, if you can shift your view set to see that in that fear, we can also realize that He is loving, and that that I think would majorly offset the distrust to move to reverence.
Just this past year, I was using Psalm 46 in the devotional, and it just kind of blew my mind a little bit, because the be still and know that I am God, I always heard in a very, you know, sweet devotional way, right? Be still, just, but it comes right after that, come behold the works of the Lord. He has brought desolations on the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the vow and shatters the spear. He burns chariots of fire. Be still and know that I'm God. So it actually really made that verse pop for me to put it in its context. Wow, this is not just like, go out into the trees and be still. Like, there is chaos and destruction happening all around you. Be still and know that I'm God. Did you find that when you were studying these Psalms, was there anything like that? Did you like, oh, I've always read that verse, but now I'm like, whoa, or anything that surprised you, I guess, in your research or in your
I'd actually say the same verse, if I'm being honest, because that really stuck out to me also, seeing all the chaos and all the like wars and all the hardships and all the pain, and then seeing be still. Like, I hate to copy, but like, that's exactly what it stood out to me also. Just seeing that we can have peace and we can have refuge in Him, even when there are so many terrible things happening.
It reminded me of Job as well.
Yes.
God speaking to Job out of the whirlwind.
How do you act in the world? Like, right when we have that hope, like, it doesn't negate the fact that things are still happening. So how do you kind of balance that, like, acknowledging that there's certain things that are happening while also trusting the Lord? Like, what do you think that looks like?
I'd say the website Saturday God by John Piper was definitely the most helpful. A lot of my sources were from that website, just because I felt like he was able to communicate what I wanted to communicate in a better way than I could. And then he just had all the scriptural background for it, and it was incredibly helpful. Yeah, highly recommend the website.
Psalms 46:4, it says, there's a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. And verse 5, God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. And you noted how this river paints a picture of God's refuge. And I was just wondering, I was like craving more. Like when you made that connection, when you talked about it, I was like, could you elaborate more on it?
Sure. So in Israel, there were no such rivers, right? And so when it's written of in this psalm, it's giving a picture to us and to people back then that God is like a river. He's stable. He's providing, I guess. Because back then it was streams. And so, I just felt like that is said, there's a river that makes glad the city of God. It's just saying that he will provide throughout all of that. That God is in this for she should not be moved. To provide that stability in the fact that God will provide.
Did your research for your preparation of this thesis provoke any additional questions about God's nature or theology? Did it bring up anything that you weren't expecting to ponder when you started this project?
I think it brought up what refuge means. More, less in like paper sense and more in like what is the Hebrew word for refuge, how is it used throughout the Bible. In doing that, actually, I had to go back through and change the verses because I realized that our translation of refuge is slightly different. So like there's two or three words that also mean refuge in different senses in Hebrew and then in English they all translated to just refuge. And so I had to go back through and change places and make sure I was using the same sort of refuge so I could speak about the same thing throughout my thesis. So I can get a broader question about like the meaning of words like in English and in Hebrew.
Right. Words.
Yes. I know the story, but I really did not go into it just because I was trying to focus specifically on his songs. That was an interesting thing that I realized after.
What is this?
Right, just for those who are here. So it's Psalm 91:11. He will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. So that's what Satan used.
Could you maybe go into detail about how God, or how, like the story of Jesus in the New Testament when Satan was attacking him?
I need to get my Bible, probably, because I didn't do any research on that, so I feel a little bit maybe unprepared trying to speak on a topic I haven't studied it.
Yeah. I think it is cool just kind of knowing the basis of it, why Jesus turned to God as his refuge, like Satan was presenting him with all of these appealing things when he was struggling, when he was hungry, when he was thirsty, when he was tired and wanted to give up. I think it's such a picture that even like Jesus, who was 100% God and 100% man in that moment, like,
was able to take her.
Yeah, he saw the beauty and turned to the Lord.
Good point. Good. That's all you. Okay. So do you have any final statements to Ava?
I did have one more question. Do they still use invitation to the Psalms in Challenge 4? Is that still
last year?
Last
Challenge
year.
3. Oh, last semester? Last semester, yes, we do.
We did last semester.
We read it at some point. We read so much. Yeah.
I just wondered if that text, if studying that text, like helped you choose this topic, or if there's anything in that text that you used to inform your study of this, of these things.
I didn't directly use the book, but it definitely was impactful when I did read it, and so I think it was definitely somewhat of encouragement to get into this course.
Yeah. I loved it. After getting to know you the past couple of years, I know that this paper comes from the heart of somebody that believes it. Which is what's so cool. You're so authentic, and I know that God is a refuge for you, and I can see it in your walk. I can see it in the way you talk and the way that you talk to other people. And I just commend you for that. For being honest and for being for loving the Lord and being an example of what it looks like to be a child that turns to Him as His refuge. I just think you're wonderful and awesome. And I love getting to read that.
And our culture today is looking for refuge in all the wrong things, right? In identity, in politics, you name it. Our souls are longing for refuge, and so it's definitely something that our culture and the world needs, and so we'll have many opportunities, I'm sure, to encourage people to seek refuge where it can help.
And I think at this point in time, that is happening. I think there is a turnaround happening. I think you see it in this Jesus movement. You see it in the Asbury. You see it in these students, what they're doing. I just think that that there is a take back of it, that it's gone a little too far. And I think you see Jesus at every moment saying, nope, we're bringing this back. Let's reel this in. And we just pray for that regularly. And I think these students are going to be amazing to go out into the communities and everything that they've been able to learn through this curriculum, through the studies we've had, through the numerous books of Mere Christianity and the Book of the Psalms, and just the way that we're able to communicate in class and dialogue through class and not have a fear of that, that it's been a blessing, I think, for all of us. And I think, to God's glory, we can go out and speak with reverence to Him and know that it's coming from our heart, that is truly what all these students believe. And I thank you, Ava. You did a fantastic job.